Thank you very much, Leonardo. Yes, actually, in fact, Pauli won't be there, unfortunately, because Eisenberg has taken all the space. It's enough to speak about it. So the idea of the talk today is to explicate the relationship that Heisenberg had with Goethe, and in a sense, and by reflection, Newton too, as it shines through this lecture that he held in 1941, but Heisenberg held in 1941, but by doing that, by properly contextualizing in the light of the long Heisenberg's long-term reflection and the context in which these are situated. Heisenberg's lecture in question is somewhat, I would say, unpretentiously entitled The Teachings of Goethe and Newton on Color in the Light of Modern Physics. In fact, I must say the theory of color is somewhat of a pretext. It is an excuse, we can say. It is certainly not Heisenberg's aim to add yet another opinion to the pile of the Goethe-Newton polemics. And what interests Heisenberg is the spirit and the motivation behind the dispute. It is, in a sense, a dialectic tension between Goethe and Newton that happens to be once again relevant for the science of his days, of Heisenberg's days, and the debates around the position and the aim of the scientific description of the world in relation to other possible descriptions. We'll see that these debates were very heated in that time, and so it's very important to relate it to that context. But let's take it step by step. According to Heisenberg, both Newton and Goethe, taken separately, have to teach something. Examining the theory with an open mind, I would say very much without scientific prejudices, Heisenberg, to begin with, shows an exemplary comprehension of both perspectives. But I don't want to dwell on that in detail here. I would like to point out just one aspect of that, how it is clear to Heisenberg that the two theories address, as he says, different strata or levels of reality. And nonetheless, the aspiration of Goethe, not differently than in fact Newton's, is towards acquiring and transmitting a real understanding of the world. And I quote here to clarify that in a few sentences by Heisenberg. Heisenberg says, it would be an equal mistake to believe that the poet Goethe had more interest in arousing a vivid impression of the world than in acquiring a real understanding of it. Every genuinely great work of creative writing transmits a real understanding of all aspects of life, otherwise difficult to grasp. These latter aspects intersects, is this one that intersects with Heisenberg's, we could say, self-questioning about the place of the mathematical description of the world that is championed by the physical sciences in the wake of Newton, with respect to the description of the world promoted by an artist like Goethe, for example. Heisenberg seems to struggle with questions like, can one today have the former without completely belittling and outshining the latter? So the scientific description and the other forms of description. Is there a way to keep them both, in a sense? Or what does Goethe's position mean today? With this in mind, the dispute between Goethe and Newton becomes relevant. It is here that it becomes relevant for Heisenberg. As I said, it is the synthesis between the two that Heisenberg searches for. And also, it is also that the motivation why he reconsiders the opposition. But why, we might ask, and here we come to the context, why we might ask, in the face of the successes of science, is there a need for a synthesis? Why Heisenberg is searching for such a synthesis? He's on the scientific side. Well, precisely because of the successes of science, I would say. To clarify this, we should understand, I would say, the personal, the historic context in which Heisenberg's reflections situate. I read another excerpt that clarifies that from the same 1941 lecture. Heisenberg says, Goethe's struggle against the physical theory of color will have to be continued today on an extended front. Helmholtz said of Goethe that this theory of color must be regarded as an attempt to save the immediate truth of sense impression from the attacks of science. Today, and here Heisenberg says, this task is more urgent than ever. The whole world is being transformed by enormous extensions of our scientific knowledge and by the wealth of its technical applications. But like all wealth, this can be a blessing or a curse. Hence, and Heisenberg said, many warning voices have been raised during recent years, counseling us to turn back. So the warning voices is an important hint that he gives us. These kind of warnings are not extemporary references in Heisenberg's thought, and that's important to notice. In a lecture given 4 years earlier, in 1937, Heisenberg speaks in similar terms, and I quote, "This search for mathematical structure of phenomena has given rise to an accusation," again, "it is said that it illuminates only certain and at that not the most essential aspects of nature, and rather than being of help in an immediate and general understanding of nature, it is actually a hindrance. The precondition for an active, practical intervention in the material world," says Heisenberg, "is this conscious knowledge of mathematically formulated law. Behind this, however, there is a direct understanding of nature, unconsciously accepting these mathematical structures and mentally recreating them." Here we wish to underscore the last few sentences as well as the accusations to which Heisenberg lends the ear, as these accusations anticipate the reconsideration of the tension between Goethe and Newton 4 years later, from the talk, the lecture we have read some experts from. We can notice that Heisenberg takes the mathematization of nature and the abstraction of modern physics, which were accused to be corresponsible for the alienation from nature fostered by modern science and technology, and considers them as not at odds with the direct understanding of nature promoted by Goethe, but as a complementary aids for that. He's searching for a reconciliation. Aside from the solution proposed by Heisenberg, on which we will briefly come back later, what we would like to understand is the nature of these accusations, where these accusations come from, where these warning voices that Heisenberg refers to come from. For that, I consider most suggestive and historically meaningful to extract two passages from the public conferences that Husserl held in 1938, shortly before his death, that were part of this volume, The Crisis of the European Sciences. I could have, in fact, as well extracted from Spengler, Heidegger, Mann, as they all pretty much touch the same point, the same conflict. But I read from Husserl, and I quote, "As a consequence of the awakened striving for philosophical knowledge, knowledge we determine the true and objective being of the world, the empirical art of measuring and its objectivizing function was idealized and turned into the purely geometrical way of thinking." And then in another passage, Husserl speaks in these terms. "For Platonism, the real had more or less perfect metaxis in the ideal. This afforded ancient geometry possibility of an application to reality. But through Galileo's mathematization of nature, nature itself is idealized under the guidance of the new mathematics. Nature itself becomes a mathematical manifold." And closing the quote. So these two brief passages from Husserl condense the essence of the accusations. Husserl speaks about modern science as having transformed the empirical art of measuring into a way of knowing nature, and then with time into the only true way of knowing nature. That is, modern science poses itself, according to these thinkers, as the only description of the world which can lead to the ultimately stable true knowledge of it, what is the ancient Greek called episteme, something that stays, something is stable. The accusation or warning voices which figure in Heisenberg's speeches, both in 37 and 41, referred silently, tacitly, to the widespread concern of the time, according to which scientists, having gotten accustomed to their successful abstractions and artificial experimental condition, the manipulation of nature in their laboratories, were, willing or not, pushing aside other ways of knowing nature and claiming a priority over these on the basis of science material success. Considering that this is the atmosphere that Heisenberg is immersed in, the implicit question that pressures him, both as a man and a scientist, is, then how can scientific investigation, which has been since the beginning the path of liberation from our senses, we could say through the objective techniques, how could this, the scientific, be also direct, some kind of direct experience of nature? How to regain a sort of direct understanding of nature, which Goethe seems to promote, with the now irrevocable paradigm of Newtonian science, within and even within the even more abstract quantum mechanical paradigm, which pushed further this mathematization. In fact, we shall point out how in the case of quantum mechanics, the question was even graver, these questions were even graver, as its increasing abstraction would just, in case, exacerbate the criticism of the type we have read in Husserl. So, Heisenberg responds in this way. First of all, he considers that the meter separation between our physical theories and our sensory experience that have been compelled by quantum mechanically categorically excluded a naive conflation of the two, thereby even more exhorting to the task of finding a renewed relation between that direct experience and mathematical intuition. But Goethe's visceral rejection of Newtonian optics made leverage in our senses, and that was no longer a valid way to go about, not even a vague possibility in the world of microphysics. So Heisenberg's answer is therefore to stay within the path of science and push its tendency to the mathematical abstraction to their limits. Like a mathematician or an artist working on abstract frontiers, according to Heisenberg, we have to transform, in a sense, we have to try to transform for how much it is possible and re-educate our intuition to the highly abstract pictures that the refined techniques of observation and measurement that science has, that these techniques bring to light. We have to really try to find a new intuition that is based on the mathematics. Ideally, in a sense, we could say the scientist should become so familiar with phenomena that are experienced through the experiments in the lab that mathematical laws would appear merely as a useful summary of his experiences. So, we could say, if science has represented since the beginning the attempt to describe the world to the extent that it is independent of our thoughts and actions, its destiny was, according to Heisenberg, to become more abstract and distant from common experience. This was unavoidable. Then the synthesis between Goethe and Newton seems therefore obtainable not by turning back unrealistically from this road that science has set in, but by following to the end, in a sense. This way first lets us see, because the mathematical description lets us see with wide clarity interconnections that would be completely precluded to our senses and can provide us with a sense of unity between its manifestations that, after all, is not that different than the one searched for by Goethe. This is a sort of solution that Heisenberg has to offer, or a proposition, to those warning voices that were warning against the science to turn back. Now, I come to the conclusions. Leaving for now aside the judgment on the feasibility of Heisenberg's attempt at reconciling the synthetic artistic description with the scientific description of the objects of nature, two are the historiographical messages we want to give. First, one cannot read but in Heisenberg, crossing the text of various of his conferences, his wish to respond to the critics of the abstract and cold scientific image of the world. We said Husserl, we could have quoted others. Certainly, the conference we have examined has attracted some attention. I mean, it's been already analyzed, those, but it seems to us in an insufficient or one-sided way. On the one hand, there are philosophically inclined paraphrases of Heisenberg's talk, but ironically, this philosophically knowledgeable readers that one would expect to claim, at least to point out about the warning voices that Heisenberg engages with, we would expect them to mention, but this actually has not been the case. It's in the philosophically oriented readings, there is almost no mention of this background, this important background of Heisenberg's engaging with Goethe and Newton. This takes us to the second message. The whole of German culture of the time is imbued with Goethean thought and still confronts it. And not just for literary reasons. So Heisenberg's consideration of Goethe is not an instrumental choice. It is not the result of some hidden agenda, as some of these readings seem to convey, but a response to the debate around the place and name of the scientific description in relation to other description of the world. This was a very, very heated debate at the time. There, Heisenberg's is a response that does not endorse the literal, anachronistic, and attainable continuation of the represented by the warning voices, but rather extracts and reactivates the essence of Goethe's criticism. If we are to come, it seems to suggest, and here is the last sentence I give, if we are to counterbalance the Newtonian vision in which our world is immersed, we shall reintegrate the opposite pole by seeking this dialectical synthesis between them instead of assuming this irreconcilable contrast. Thank you very much. Sorry, I went very much over time.
We have time for some questions. Please raise your hand. I heard a bit, but I cannot see her.
No, that I think is probably no.
Any question from the museum? Mr.